the link.
We're recording. Now we're recording. Okay. I'm
the same if we're recording or not recording. I was told by your producer, Alex, who tells me he's only 28.
Mm-hmm.
That, by the way, was the age I was elected mayor, but who's okay. plugging that? Anyway, he tells me that you won an award, a writer's award, for something to do with that dog Triumph. And that triumphant dog, whom I happen to like, partly because I like dogs and partly because I like cigars. So when you combine a cigar-smoking dog, you're there. And he told me, he promised me, your producer, the condition of my appearing on this show was that he would send me the link, and I have not received it.
The link to what?
To that show that for which you won an award.
Well, we don't need to talk about me right now. When we're done, we'll talk about my...
Am I going to get a link?
You'll get a link, some sausages.
We can proceed and talk. Go ahead.
Thank you.
How are you, David?
It's great to hear your voice, sir. It really is.
It can't be that great. You could have called me a year ago. You have a telephone? It's like an old girlfriend. Oh, I was longing to hear from you. Pick up a phone. It's true.
Here's what I'm going to do to my listeners, because I have a lot of...
That's what you're going to do to your listeners. Okay.
I'm going to talk to you for a little while, and then I'm going to tell them who you are. We're just going to talk, and then we're going to peel it back a little, and when they find out who you are and what your story is, their jaws are going to drop. This has been happening lately.
Their jaws or their drawers? this is an important distinction because I'm out of here. I'm hanging up in a minute if they're drawers. I didn't think it was that kind of a show, really.
All right.
This
upsetting. I'm not going to give you the usual introduction because you haven't done the show in a while.
That, by the way, that's... I wonder why that is. The producer was looking down. They had a spare half hour to make look. We're under the R's. Jeffrey Ross wasn't available to go with Burt Ross. I know how this works. By the way, the fact that somebody cannot be defined by a story or by what somebody did, that's not who I am.
I know
that's
that.
Not the essence of the person.
I know.
You would know that. You're back in New York. You don't know that.
I know that. You've become a Malibu... You know, you're. Well, we'll talk about you, but you're now this.
I am a Malibu. The word, we have a word for it. Malibuite.
I call you Malibourgeoisie. That's who you are.
We have no idea what's happening outside our borders, nor do we want to.
No interest. To me, I always am jealous of people who've never seen The Godfather, because it's going to be brand new and they're fresh. It's a tabula rasa, as pretentious people say. And I am jealous of my listeners. We have new listeners, and I'm jealous of the new listeners who don't know who you are. And we're going to talk for a little while. And then,
do they know who you are?
No, I don't even know who I am. We're going to talk for a little while, and then they're going to go, oh, my God.
Then they're going to drop their drawers, and I'm out of here.
Tell me about avocado season.
I have the most beautiful avocado tree. It's maybe, I've been told, what do I know? I'm a Jew from Jersey, just like you. 17, 18 years old. And it takes a pause. It sleeps for about a year. And then for about a year and a half, it produces hundreds. There is a guy named Stephen Goldstein who was the, the head of the, I forget, Gay Alliance in New Jersey. Few years ago. Now he heads the Anne Frank Institute in New York Foundation. And Stephen was here, and he picked a couple of avocados.
Hang on. There's got to be... Hang on for 1 second. So he went from the closet to the attic.
Well, you're talking about climbing the ladder to pick avocados as the attic?
No, I'm saying...
Oh, Anne Frank attic. Ah,
he was
very good.
The Gay Alliance. Then he started working for Anne Frank.
You know, look, you're doing exactly what I have to do with most of my jokes. You didn't have to. You then have to explain the joke.
Oh, by the way, this whole show is about me explaining a joke because nobody gets my jokes. So this whole show
I can relate to that, David.
Yeah.
He's up there and he picks an avocado and he turns around and he says, this is the most rural thing I have ever done. Stephen was played by Stephen Carell in a movie, the name of which escapes me.
The Big Short.
Different movie.
Bruce Almighty. Stephen Carell. Is he God? Steve Goldstein is.
You have to stop this now.
Okay, sorry.
There was a movie with Julianne Moore. She played a dying lesbian police officer in New Jersey, and she was denied. Her partner was denied all the rights to inherit or to visit. And Stephen Carell played Stephen Goldstein, who was head of the Gay Alliance and who went wild and protested. And the New York Times, apparently, I didn't read it, but I was told, reviewed that Stephen Carell's portrayal of Stephen Goldstein was too over the top. And when you meet Stephen Goldstein, you'll realize he underplayed it. Stephen Goldstein is out there. Anyway.
How did you meet Stephen Goldstein? Which bar?
Not that there's anything wrong with it.
Right.
My dear friend, Loretta Weinberg, who is either president or majority leader of the New Jersey Senate, who is an absolutely fabulous human being, and has been the biggest thorn in Governor Christie's ample side, rear end.
I have a question about that. Didn't she remove a thorn from Bill Christie's foot and they became friends? Because he's an elephant.
I never met Bill Christie. Bill Christie.
Chris
Christie, never met him.
I'm doing a joke about a mouse removing the thorn from the elephant's foot. It was a bad joke. I apologize.
So,
I'm going to shut
up.
Saturday
Night Live thing where a guy, where I forget his name, but he, for the hearing impaired,
Morris.
The news would be broadcast, and then he would shout it louder. And that's like what you have to do with your jokes. After you tell the joke, then you do an interpretive period.
Okay. I apologize. Okay. I'm just so excited to hear your voice. I'm so excited.
I had too much coffee. Go ahead.
I'm so excited to hear your voice, and it's been too long. So Goldstein, and he was portrayed by Steve Carell in a movie. And how did you meet Mr. Goldstein?
As I just said, through Loretta Weinberg, my dear friend, who is the majority leader of the New Jersey Senate, who is a fabulous liberal who really was responsible for the uncovering of Bridgegate. And she's been on 60 Minutes to Face the Nation. She's been for gay rights and for some reasonable kind of gun control, something where you might at least have the opportunity to buy a gun where you have your fingerprints analyzed so that only you can operate the gun.
Mm-hmm.
Might be a good idea if you have children in the house.
Yeah.
So she's just been fabulous. But she's also a wonderful person with a great sense of humor.
Would she come on this show?
I can't imagine she wouldn't. And you'll have your producer. Your people will talk to my people.
We're the same people.
I know. And Stephen Goldstein was head of the Gay Alliance, so she and Loretta became very close because Loretta very much believes in marriage equality, which she fought for, and so she had him out to Malibu. She's actually originally from Beverly Hills. Too much about Loretta. Loretta can talk about herself.
Sweet Loretta moved from Beverly Hills to New Jersey. You moved from New Jersey to Malibu.
There were about 50 years in between.
Yeah.
But Loretta's daughter and grandchildren live in Culver City, which your New York listeners have no idea what that means.
It's where Sony is headquartered.
I have no idea. You know so much more about California than
I do. Pay attention, new listeners, because Burt Ross just mentioned New Jersey. And we're going to We'll circle back to New Jersey because when we'll tell his New Jersey story in a little while. And when we do, you're going to say, my God, the David Feldman show is the most fascinating, most surprising podcast in the history of the medium. Because when they hear
do you realize that after all the times I've been on your show, I still haven't a clue what a podcast is?
Either to my listeners. And if they ever find out, they're going to listen to Mark Maron.
So, I heard a rumor.
Yeah.
That you're one of your sponsors is Ovaltine. And I want to tell you that is great because I love chocolate milk. I used to believe that chocolate milk came from brown cows. I mean, I was a little naive. Where are most of your listeners from? You have any idea? Is there a geographic analysis?
The bottom of their class. That I know.
Wonderful. My God, you give the man a lob and he just smacks it over the net.
Now, you're living in Malibu. You used to live in New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
Let's brag about your daughter. You know, don't give her name. Don't do it. But you have a magnificent daughter. Don't you?
I shouldn't mention her name because if you're ashamed of somebody, if my daughter had been in prison, I wouldn't use her name.
Okay.
But she's a pediatrician saving children's lives. Again with the yawning when I talk. It's amazing. Okay, you always
did you say
questions.
Something?
Go ahead.
Did you say something about your daughter? I'm sorry. What does she do? What does she do? I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
I moved to California. Both of my children lived in L.A. And now my son has moved back several years ago. My daughter's moving back to New York. I don't know whether that says anything about their feelings towards their parents. I don't know. I'd have to go to an analysis.
Look up in the sky. Do you see a ton of bricks about to fall on you?
No, I see. Actually, what's very rare in here in town is a very light rain. One day I said to a woman, boy, that was some rain. She said, it didn't rain. I said, what do you mean it didn't rain? She said, that was ocean mist. I said, well, how can you tell the difference between rain and ocean mist? And she said, when your intermittent wipers aren't enough, that's rain.
Hmm.
So that's what happens in Malibu. I'm sure everybody took notes on that.
Yes, ocean mist. That's a great name.
Sounds like doesn't that sound like a cranberry juice or something?
Yeah, or it sounds like a female product. Your daughter's a pediatrician.
Yes, that's exactly. She actually has been working in the hospital at UCLA. So when a pediatrician works in a hospital, why are you asking the questions then? I'm going to give you from here on in, Buster. You got the shovel, and you're digging the grave? From here on in, I'm going to give you one-word answers. See how you like that, big fella. We'll see who's the ones. Go ahead.
All right, so your daughter's a pediatrician.
Yes.
Big whoop. Tony Soprano's eyes are welling up. That's what he wanted for Meadow, for her to... That's what every father wants for his daughter, is for her
Correct.
To be a pediatrician. Right?
Yes. Right.
You are a perfect human being. You really are. And my listeners who are going way back know that. But you really are a perfect human being. And what people who are just joining this nonsense need to know is that growing up, you and Ralph Nader were my heroes.
Oh, God.
And by the way, I just got off. I swear to God, I just got off the phone with Ralph Nader. By the way. Just got off the phone with Ralph Nader. Growing up, my father, who said to me...
By the way, you then, if you're a correct member of the tribe, after you say your father, you say, may he rest in peace.
Right, but he's still alive. So he's taking a nap?
He's still alive.
Well, he's dead, but I haven't gotten around to burying him yet. No, he actually...
Is your dad alive?
No, he passed away. Actually, he passed away 2 decades ago this time of year.
Yeah, that's what you had told me. I didn't,
yeah. But
okay.
So
your
growing
mother's alive, though.
So growing
your mother
up,
is alive.
My mother's very much alive.
And how old is she?
Well, I'm not allowed to talk about her age, but she looks great. She really does.
I've told that when you want a vacation, you go and be with her.
I spend a lot of time with my mother. Yes, I do.
And you call that vacation?
Let's move on. You know, yes, I do.
If you're gonna yawn when you ask me about my daughter and I answer, you get the gloves on, buddy. I can handle it.
You have a daughter who's a pediatrician.
Yes.
I mean that's you're done. you're done. Just, you know, that's you go to a party. And you go, I got a daughter. She's a pediatrician. Game, set, match. What else is there to discuss?
Apparently not much. I bet that you don't get blowback from Ralph like this.
I would never talk to Ralph the way I talk to you. But let me just introduce...
You talk to him with more respect.
If it makes you feel uncomfortable, yes, I do. Because growing up...
By the way, it's only that you answer that yes because it makes me uncomfortable. If it made me comfortable, you would probably come up with a different answer.
I would never talk to Ralph Nader and show him the disrespect that I go out of my way to show Burt Ross.
Because Ralph Nader doesn't have a sense of humor. He's humorless. It's the closest thing to eating Wonder Bread. I mean, you know.
Like he would ever eat Wonder Bread. Are you kidding?
No, probably not.
Growing up, there were two moments that I remember vividly. And this is the God's honest truth. And I'm going to say one nice thing about Burt Ross. And I'm going to get back to disrespecting him. Because, by the way, it drives my mother crazy that I don't show you respect.
And your mother is a great woman. And mm-hmm. She probably doesn't listen to your podcast.
No, she does.
Well, then... The Mrs. Feldman, I love you. You are so perceptive, and you should absolutely tell David to show some more, to show not more respect, but a modicum of respect wouldn't be bad. Look, I'm still doing things. I don't rest on the laurels of coming up with seatbelts. The fact that he saves 30 million lives, that's old news. What has he done for us lately?
Occupational Safety and Hazard Administration, the Clean Water Act, the EPA, Burt Ross, the EPA. It's pretty...
Clean water. Clean water. Clean water is overrated. You know, when I go to a restaurant, they say, would you like bottled water? I say, no, I'd like some dirty water. Fresh from the wherever. Okay.
Growing up, two vivid memories. One is, I'm eating ice cream in my parents' bedroom. We're watching Channel 5 News. Ralph Nader is...
They allowed you to eat ice cream in the bedroom?
Yeah.
Mrs. Feldman, a shanda. So, I'm sorry. At least I hope it wasn't with meat. Let's go on.
Shellfish-flavored ice cream from Ben & Jerry's. So, I'm watching... the news, and Ralph Nader's testifying, and I go, who's this guy? And my father, Greatest Generation, loses it. Who's this guy? And he stands in front of the television, he goes, that's your hero. And I said, what are you talking about? I don't know who this guy is. He says, if you call Ralph Nader this guy, I'm going to take that ice cream away from you. That is your hero. Find out who he is. And he bought me Unsafe at Any Speed. I was like 9 years old, and I had to read Unsafe at Any Speed. And my father commanded that Ralph Nader be my hero. At the same time, like a couple of years later, I'm not going to tell the audience why, but the Bergen Record used to come, the newspaper, every morning, and Burt Ross. And my father would say, now that's a Jew. Burt, if you had half the integrity of Burt Ross.
Wait a minute. One guy's a hero and one guy's a Jew? That's it? That's the whole Godzilla? Mike, he could go to shul and say, here's a bunch of Jews. What kind of, what is this? This is very upsetting. Go ahead.
And not only that, but sexy. The women in my house.
Okay.
The women, don't tell, can I say the name of your lovely wife?
Joan.
My sister
and your mother. Oh, God.
And their friends, and there were pictures of Burt Ross in the newspaper on the cover of New York Magazine.
David, I have one question.
Yes.
Did these women, when they saw Ralph Nader, when you were eating ice cream, did your mother or your sister or their friends say, what a sexy guy? Answer the question, please.
You were the Eddie Fisher of my generation.
Oh, God.
Every Jewish girl wanted Burt Ross. I'm telling you that, and
no Gentiles wanted me?
I'm telling you, Burt Ross, not just in my house, but you were treated, when your name was mentioned, the angels sang, I could hear the harps. So we'll get to you in a little
bit. I have to interrupt because there's a short story which really I love. When I was in college, I looked a lot like Omar Sharif, except for the space missing between the two teeth. And this was after Dr. Zhivago came out, and so I wore the Russian hat and the Russian coat, and women would come up to me, and I was having a very nice time. Now we move forward 40-something years. I go to a Yankee game in Camden Yards. I decided Yankee Stadium was too much tumult, and I thought I was very creative and unique. And as I'm going down the New Jersey Turnpike to Baltimore, and I stop at a gas station, everybody there is wearing a Yankee hat. Anyway, I go to Camden Yards, and I'm with my wife, and behind me is a woman probably in her late 40s, and she gets all excited. I figure, you know, Omar Sharif.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, oh, my God, you look like, and she thinks and says, Abe Vigoda. Now, my computer is going full speed because I know it can't be who she said it is. I said, you don't mean the guy who played Fish? She says, yeah. So my mind still does. The guy in The Godfather? Yeah.
I don't get it.
And
I don't see Abe Vigoda.
Abe Vigoda.
Don't see it.
Didn't, in deference to Abe, who departed in his mid-90s a year ago, even his mother didn't like the way he looked. He wouldn't even look in the mirror. I couldn't believe it. I said to the woman, you're very lucky they have gun control in Baltimore. I would have just shot you and sat down. And it was like, so you realize what happens in 40 years. From Omar Sharif to Abe Vigoda does not get worse.
No, it doesn't.
I'll shut up.
No, that's a great, I love that.
So,
I love
women
that.
Are apparently no longer, other than my wife, thank God, coming on to me. Go ahead.
Tell me about your humor column. You write a weekly humor column for the Malibu Times.
It's a strange thing. I write, when I first came to Malibu, I went to their couple of papers here, and I said I would like to write a humor column pretty much based on an Easterner's view of the new country. And
like a gefilte fish out of water.
Exactly. And one of the publishers said, wait a minute, you've been here 8 days and you want to do this? I said, no, you don't understand. It's not a historical perspective like Alexis de Tocqueville coming to America from France. This is, you know, more a comedy, you know, a humor column. So finally, after 2 years, I wrote for what's called the Malibu Patch, and then I started to write for the Malibu Times, which is the major newspaper here. And I was supposed to write every other week. And I've now submitted 8 or 9 columns in a row, and I don't think they figured out, as they do it every week, that it has switched to a weekly column. But they've allowed me to write almost anything I want to. There's been almost no censorship. It's been a wonderful experience because, like you, it's almost like we have glasses that we wear, and we see things through this humor filter. So all day long, I'm writing things down because I just see the humor in things, which I guess helps me get through life. But I really enjoy it. It's cathartic.
Is it online?
Yes. If you were to go to it starts as a blog. On Monday afternoons, they post the new ones, and then Thursday, the paper comes out, and then it's in the paper. So it's a blog and online, and then it's a column in the paper. It's the same thing. If you go online to the Malibu Times and you search Burt Ross, you'll see all the columns, or you'll go to, when you go to the Malibu Times online, under Opinion, you click Opinion, and then below it is Blogs, and then you'll see all my blogs.
So the first time you and I ever talked, you don't remember this.
Yes, I do. I very much do.
You're wrong, but go ahead.
The first time we talked was at Dwight Morrow High School.
It's 10 years ago, but you're wrong.
Performed.
Hang on, 10 years ago, and you're wrong, but go ahead.
You're saying we talked before that.
Yeah, but go ahead. Tell what happened.
And you performed. There were a bunch of people performed, and I thought you were terrific. And I had no idea. I mean, here are guys from the class performing, and you did, I would say, something like 10 minutes of original, you know, material. And it seemed to me to be a very professional level. I had no idea, you know, who you were or what your background was. And
Hang on for one second. One of the Isley brothers. This was a benefit for Dwight Morrow High School.
He was very good too.
One of the Isley brothers was there and played, right?
The Star Spangled Banner, in a way you can only play if you're on drugs. It was terrific.
Because Jimi Hendrix used to play with the Isley brothers.
And I didn't know that.
Yeah. So in honor of Jimi Hendrix, I can't remember the name of, I don't want to do a disservice to him, but he played and then.
He did very well. But there was also a guy who.
Rick
was
Overton?
There was a guy who started off, or one of the first performers who did some comedy, and it was horrific. It was beyond amateurish.
But then we had Richard Lewis and Rick Overton.
No. Richard Lewis wasn't there. Richard Lewis said hello from that on a tape from a remote location, probably here in L.A.
Okay.
As you recall, Richard Lewis's father, Bill Lewis, may he rest in peace, owned Ambassador Caterers, and you could not be Jewish and get bar mitzvah if Bill didn't do your bar mitzvah. Then you were a Christian.
And Jeff Ross's parents owned the number one catering house in Newark, New Jersey.
I did not know that.
They catered the riots in 16.
Jeff has been doing very well.
Yes, he has. I wish I was talking to him right now instead of you.
I don't blame. As a matter of fact, I would rather be talking to Jeff now than you. Jeff did something. I think it was Jeff, so correct me if I'm wrong. He did some material where he went into a penitentiary.
Yes. Unfortunately, and he got out. They let him out, unfortunately.
Well, I taught when I was at college in a couple of different prisons. And all I can tell you is that is guts ball. That is something, you know, you're a comedian and you know a tough audience. And what he did was not only go in there and do his regular shtick, he did like a Don Rickles kind of material with that audience.
Yeah.
And that is, and he pulled it off.
Yeah. I helped him with that.
Well, I'll tell you, whatever was done, that is, that's courageous. You're a comedian. I have to ask you a question.
Now, hang on, let me talk about prisons for a second. Hold that. Put a pin in that. There's a great comedian named Rick Reynolds who tells a legendary story about me and him and a guy named Jose Simone playing Santa Rita Prison. I think it's called a level 5. I mean, just like the maximum security prison for Christmas. Mm. I can't do it justice, but if you Google it, just Google Rick Reynolds prison story.
Do me a favor. When this show is over, have Alex send me, Alex is your 28-year-old producer, the link for that and the link for the dog with the cigar.
This is what I remember. So I performed. I had an anxiety attack. Like, and
did you take them on? Like Jeff did?
No, Rick Reynolds did. But I'll tell you what happened to me. Yeah, I went up. And I go, good evening, ladies and... Oh, I do that first. I go,
oh, God. Oh, God.
Oh. And I did it by accident. I just went, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So
I think that other than the correspondence dinner, where practically every single comic has bombed, I think going into a prison and doing Don Rickles kind of material has got to be one of the most challenging jobs for a comedian.
Yeah. Well, hopefully the next White House correspondence.
I read Steve Martin's autobiography. And these are in the early days, and he's up in San Francisco. And they give him a Monday night, which is absolutely, you know, the worst night. And he comes out, and they tell him, it's a big night. The place is full, standing room only. He doesn't understand it. He comes out, and they're all Japanese tourists. And they don't speak English. And I would have... If I had been a comedian, I would have passed out. They would have had EMT people doing, you know, helping me breathe. And he starts juggling and doing all the other things he can do and pulled it off. And that to me is, whenever I aspire to being a comedian and I look at somebody who can do that, I realize I should stay home.
Well, the advantage that I have over Steve Martin is my act is received exactly the same way between Japanese businessmen and people who speak English. I get the same reaction. It's same universal. Reaction. I can go anywhere and get the same response.
I remember speaking to you one time from Reno. I forget the audience that you just had, but boy, you were breathing heavily. It was.
Did you come see me in Reno?
No. I wish you had once in your life told me where you're performing, I remotely near where I live, because I'd love to come and hear you. I mean,
it's an invasion of my privacy. So
people who are listening to this show, if there's still any left, he really is a good comedian, and if you can get a chance to watch him do stand up, it's worth it.
By the way,
that's a plug. I'm plugging that in Ovaltine.
Thank you.
I like you, but Ovaltine is milk. You got to be. To drink milk without Ovaltine is...
Do they even make Ovaltine anymore?
I thought it was your sponsor.
I don't have sponsors.
Did Alex lie to me?
Wait a second. I think we're debating whether... We've been asked to have a sponsor, but we're debating... It alienates my listeners. Somebody wants to run a commercial, and every time I run a commercial, my listeners get pissed off. So I can't.
Then why am I promoting Ovaltine here?
Did he lie to you and say we're sponsored by Ovaltine?
I asked him, are you making money with this podcast? He said, yes. I said, how do you do that? He says, we have sponsors.
Okay.
Okay, what?
We don't have sponsors.
So how do you make money?
Very interesting that you would bring that up, Burt Ross.
Yes. I mean, we are in a capitalistic society.
We ask people to become monthly subscribers.
Ah.
And for $5 a month or more, if they want to give more, they can gain access to our premium content.
Mm.
And then they can do all their Amazon shopping by going to David Feldman Show website. The David Feldman Show website, there's an Amazon banner. And you click on that and you go to Amazon. And then if you shop and buy something, I get a small percentage of everything you purchase.
Hmm. So then I'll promote Amazon. The stock went to 1,000. It's a great company.
Good.
And Jeff owns, not Jeff Ross, owns the Washington Post.
Jeff Bezos.
Strange name. Yeah. What kind of name is that?
Cuban.
No.
Yeah.
Get out of here.
He's a Cuban, yeah.
Born there? No.
No, but his father or stepfather was Cuban.
He could buy Cuba.
He could buy...
No, they don't forget the embargo. You could just buy Cuba and it would be part of Amazon.
The Washington Post is, since he took it over, he has turned it into a premier newspaper, one of the all-time great news, right?
Yes.
Absolutely. The other great thing is, because of Amazon, because of Jeff Bezos, remember what it was like to walk around small-town America? You'd be walking, oh, there's a bookstore. Oh, there's a there's a used record
because
store.
Because of Jeff, there is no retail stores anymore. Brick
Thank
and mortar
God.
Is out. Malls will be all movies and restaurants.
That,
the Garden State Plaza in New Jersey will end up with 340 restaurants.
Who needs bookstores? Thank you for getting
Who needs kitchens? Do you realize that my kids haven't cooked a meal in 3 years? I don't even know why. They need a refrigerator in order to keep things fresh because they may not eat the entire meal. But everything is either they go out to eat or they order in.
Now, the first time I spoke to you was not at Dwight Morrow High School.
When you were terrific and I went up to you. Okay, who cares? When was the first time?
Okay, so you walked up to me at
and
Dwight Morrow.
And I said, this was at the Dwight Morrow reunion. I said, you were fabulous, and you saw my name tag, which had my name on it, and you got all excited and called over your sister and went into my history. When was the first time we talked?
I was a Cub reporter for the Hudson Dispatch. While I was going to college, I spent 2 summers working as a police reporter at the Hudson Dispatch in New Jersey, Jersey City.
I remember the Hudson Dispatch. They covered me.
Yes, and you were the energy czar of New Jersey. Governor Byrne of New Jersey, a Democrat, appointed Burt Ross to be the energy czar of New Jersey. And I...
You remember... Okay, yes, go ahead.
And I called to interview you to talk about New Jersey's energy policy. And I think...
Did we have one?
Well, I think because of you, New Jersey is the only state in the union where they don't have self-service gasoline stations.
No, that has nothing to do with me.
Really?
When I was appointed by the governor to be the energy czar of New Jersey, the Record wrote a kind of an interesting editorial in which it said that I was very charismatic and would probably be a very good leader, but I didn't know anything about energy. I probably didn't even know what an ohm was. So I wrote a letter to the editor. I said, dear editor, I thank you so much for your support of editorial. As far as my not knowing what an ohm is, you are 100% correct. And so I looked it up in Webster's Dictionary. It defines an ohm as a measure of electrical resistance. I must confess, I still don't have a clue what an ohm is. Having graduated college in the 1960s, I always thought an ohm was something you hummed while meditating. I got a call from the governor laughing. My major accomplishment in that 2-year stint was a right turn on red light. And, well, that actually was a fairly significant accomplishment.
Wait a second.
You can laugh.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Is that true?
Yes.
And why is that good? Why is that good for our energy policy?
Well, first of all, you're not stopping unnecessarily while you burn up gas.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also environmentally positive because for the same reason. And from the other standpoint, of course, is why would you wait it when you can make a right turn? You can save a time on your trip. So it's good on every level.
So every time people make a right turn.
Yes, they should think of me. Correct.
They should think of Burt Ross every time you make a right turn at a red light.
If you make a left turn, I don't give a rat's ass whether you think of me or not.
And now,
but
as
you make a right turn, yes.
And do you get a cut? Do you get a royalty every time?
Yes, I get a royalty, yes. So, but what's funny is I go to the governor with the idea.
Really?
Yes, there were other states that were doing it. And so I said, Governor, this is really terrific idea. And he said, you know, I don't think the Attorney General Bill Hyland likes it. So I go to Bill Hyland. I said, General Hyland, what's your view? He says, it's fine by me. I go back to the governor. The governor says, I don't think Bill Hyland likes it. I said, wait a minute. I spoke to him. He likes it. He says, okay. I had a push for something which is the dream of everybody in politics. It is almost impossible to pass legislation or to propose legislation that 99.9% of the population wants. It is just absolutely a gift to a politician, and almost nobody opposes. So finally, it passed, I think, unanimously, but it was a bit of a fight to get him to realize that this is a win-win-win-win.
Nobody, the idle lobby, isn't there a lobby for people who like to idle? Who?
Apparently not. that was exactly it.
Well, we should call it a Burt. We're in New Jersey. You can pull a Burt if you want to. It's legal.
No.
From now on, because actually, my mother lives in New Jersey. I live in New York.
Does she still live in Teaneck?
She doesn't live in Teaneck, but I don't want to tell what city. But
you are so famous.
No.
That people will start to... Paparazzi will be appearing at Mrs. Feldman's door.
It would be the Mamarazzi.
Mrs. Feldman, this is
the Mamarazzi.
He's protecting you.
Hang on,
I made a joke.
I made a joke, and you missed it. I made a great joke. It would be the
Mama's lobby.
The Mamarazzi. It wouldn't be the paparazzi. It would be the Mamarazzi.
Oh, I didn't hear it.
Well,
lobby. Mama, you unbelievable. That is funny. I feel embarrassed when you have a good one to walk over it. This is a chandelier on me.
The Mamarazzi.
Wait a minute. I don't know about you, but I have other, you know, there's a busy life here in Malibu. Haven't we talked for 3 hours yet?
It just feels like that.
Don't your listeners have to do something else?
You know what? I'm not going to tell your story. But hang on for one second. Hang on for one second. Before you go, I talked to you about the energy crisis back then. I talked to you, I interviewed you about the Paley Report. And everybody was saying what a genius Bill Paley was because he issued a report about oil reserves in the 50s and warned us that we were going to run out of oil in the 70s. Do you remember this?
No.
Everybody celebrated Bill Paley, who was the founder, not really, but he owned CBS. He didn't really found CBS.
That wasn't Bill Paley. That was another name.
No, it was Bill Paley. Bill Paley.
Bill Paley?
Bill Paley.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
I interviewed you about this, Burt.
Bill Paley. It just sounds.
Do you remember the Paley?
Paley.
Do you remember the Paley?
Bill Paley. You are right. You are right.
Of course.
Son of a.
Of course I'm right. And I talked to the energy czar of New Jersey, a guy named Burt Ross, who spoke to me about the Paley Report, and he said that Bill Paley, the chairman of the board of CBS, was asked by Eisenhower to do a study of our oil reserves.
You know, at times like this, I'm not happy I made it to 74.
You're the same age as the energy crisis. It was 1974. And Bill Paley issued this report that the world's oil reserves will be barren by 1974. And everybody said...
This program is getting barren. I mean, what are you... Are you serious?
And
you're talking about the Bill Paley report about oil going to be barren in 1970? Who are you... What is the age of your listeners?
Deaf.
Deaf.
They're deaf.
Deaf and in the bottom of their class. I get it.
All right. So
even your mother's hanging up at this point. She's saying, "Oh my God, I can't believe that my son does this for a living."
You were raving about the Paley Report and how we have
you're back to that.
Yes, because you were the energy czar of New Jersey. And
you know,
I have had
an amazing life, and you are picking a part of it that I don't even remember or care to remember.
Well, I think you need to issue a retraction because the Paley Report was wrong.
Would you please do it in my name?
There is plenty of oil.
Here. There are avocados to pick. What's wrong with you?
What? But you owe me an apology because it turns
out... I apologize.
Bill Paley...
I don't even know what you're talking about. I apologize if it can move this interview forward.
Bill Paley...
Hey, Vic.
Hey, let's just... Then we'll move on. I'll say goodbye. But Bill Paley was wrong. He canceled the Smothers Brothers and put on the Beverly Hillbillies, which wasn't so bad. And
this interview is now turning onto a rant of Bill Paley. We're back in the 1960s. The Smothers Brothers. Can you explain to is your audience all 90?
How
old is this? Do you realize that people 45 years old have no idea of anything we're talking about?
No,
they don't know Bill Paley. They don't know. They don't know Dr. King, for Christ's sake.
You met Dr. King, right?
I have a picture of me and him. I'm a little taller than he is.
I would say
better looking, but he looks better than Abe Vigoda. What the hell?
You know that I have a theory about people who call Martin Luther King Dr. King, that they're secretly racist. They go, it's.
What are you supposed to call him, Martin? Marty?
I've had people who go, Dr. King. Then it's Dr. Cosby, Dr. Mandela, Dr. Jackie Robinson, Dr. Harriet Tubman.
No. I, by the way, met Jackie twice.
Kennedy?
Jackie Robinson.
Jackie Robinson was married to JFK?
No. You're Ted Cruz's father assassinated JFK.
No.
What a guy.
Jeff Bezos.
We have things to talk about. The next time.
Jeff Bezos.
I've had enough of this interview. I think the next time we need to talk about our president and his most recent tweet of this morning, which is the state of our union was .. Covfefe. Covfefe. I couldn't have said it better. The state of our union was Covfefe. This is our president. Can't beat that. I hope your listeners think about that, and we can all come up with a... I think you should have a little like segment where people email you or tweet you or whatever the hell people do today, and they come up with the definition of what they think he meant. What could Covfefe mean? No, this morning. It's in the papers. He wrote at 3:30 in the morning or something. I don't know. Some he doesn't sleep. The state of our union was .. Covfefe. Covfefe. I'm not making this up. My wife told it to me this morning.
I see this now. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. So ask your readers. It's a great opportunity to participate.
Mm-hmm.
And have them email or tweet or whatever what they think that could possibly mean.
Before you go.
I want to go, but yes.
I know you want to go. But we're not done yet.
I have things to do. Miles to go before I sleep. Robert Frost. Thank you.
Bort, did you know Robert Frost too?
I cannot believe I'm a freshman at Harvard, and there's an English, basic English class I'm taking. And the only time I cut class, I think in 4 years, was the English class, big lecture hall. I come the next day. They said, "How did you like Robert Frost?" I said, "What are you talking about? He was a special guest, a surprise guest."
Really?
Yeah. That's my story of my life.
Mm-hmm.
David, it's been nice talking to you.
Nice talking to you. You'll come back, and then we'll tell your boring story of why you're my hero.
Or we can talk about what the president meant by the State of the Union was Covfefe,
okay.
Because I agree.
Burt Ross,
exactly.
We'll talk to you soon.
Be well, David.
Thank you. Stay on the line for 1 second.